I'm Nicholas Rosnovsky. I'm the Communications Director for the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. I'm going to fill in for Dom Tarpey today, our normal host. He's having some connection issues. So why don't we just go ahead and get right to it. So the challenges facing the provision of safe, cost-effective, and efficient healthcare are substantial and numerous. One of the challenges is diagnostic error, as delayed and wrong diagnoses represent national crises in many countries, resulting in substantial patient harm, increased healthcare costs, and decreased patient and provider satisfaction. There's a vast literature that quantifies the relationship between delayed and wrong diagnoses and increased morbidity and mortality. Clinical reasoning is seemingly as difficult to define as it is to teach. Clinicians generally know it when they see it, but rarely stop to consider what is meant by it, and more importantly, how to teach it to the next generation of clinicians. A definition of clinical reasoning includes an ability to integrate and apply different types of knowledge, to weigh evidence, critically think about arguments, and to reflect upon the process used to arrive at a diagnosis. Clinical reasoning, therefore, requires not only an accumulation of knowledge, but also a level of experience, which is generally what it sets apart a practicing clinician from a medical student or junior doctor. A key question for educators is how to accelerate the developmental process of a student into a seasoned clinician. Our speaker today, Descartes Li, has had a long-standing interest in clinical reasoning in both general medicine and mental health. He's currently the professor and vice chair for education in the UCSF Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. He gives numerous talks and presentations in both academic and community settings and has a wide range of interests that include medical education, bipolar disorder, electroconvulsive therapy, and suicide prevention. His educational motto is, "Forget teaching, remember learning." So why don't you please all join me in welcoming today's speaker, Dr. Descartes Li.
Thanks, Nick. That was an outstanding introduction.
Thank you. I was reading it for the first time, so I think it went well.
You did a great job. Thank you. So let me just get started here. I had numerous titles for this talk, but clinical reasoning is the one I'll go with for now. And making the unconscious conscious, because I think we all kind of get a sense of, okay, clinical reasoning. You get all this information from the patient and you figure out what's wrong and then you do something about it, right? Yeah, it's not so easy, although sometimes we like to think it is. So I don't have any disclosures. So the learning objectives are, and I highlighted this one, comprehend the basic vocabulary of clinical reasoning so as to better communicate with UCSF medical students. And the reason why I put that down first is because medical students, it turns out, have a training in clinical reasoning that I never had, and most of you probably never had. And they have a vocabulary in which they talk about clinical reasoning. And if you're going to do any teaching, it's super helpful to be able to talk the talk, I think. Furthermore, understanding like this method of clinical reasoning and how we teach clinical reasoning is going to be helpful for you to understand your students and assess them in a way that will be more clear to you about not only what the problem that they might have or areas that they could improve on, but also how to improve them. So this kind of has a double purpose in that I'm not only going to teach you this thing called clinical reasoning, which you already know. So by the way, I'm really good at teaching stuff that the audience already knows. So I feel good about this talk since I think you already know about clinical reasoning, but I'm going to teach you about how to apply it in the clinical setting and how to teach it in terms and how to use it for teaching purposes. Furthermore, I'll teach you like the vocabulary. And it turns out that clinical reasoning, even though it sounds like a very generic term, actually has a very specific meaning now in medicine and has its own body of and fund of knowledge and vocabulary. So I'm going to try to cue you into resources to learn more about it and also in some of the basic terminology that is taught to the students so you can talk the same language with them. So part of that is learning how to evaluate problem representation and illness scripts when demonstrated by trainees using general principles for evaluation of each component. So these underlined items are part of this vocabulary and form part of the basic conceptualization of clinical reasoning that's now pervasive in medicine. One final thing I'll say is that it's pervasive in medicine, but it's not in psychiatry. I have done a literature search. I have not found anyone in psychiatry or mental health using this method to or applying this method in the field of mental health to teach our trainees. So if anyone's interested in particular on how to do this or how to think about it or want to do some more stuff, Q Chang Lee and I are already getting started on some of this. So please feel free to reach out to me about it. Then the other two kind of concepts and vocabulary words are schemas. We all know what the word schemas mean, but they're particular in this area. And what is a prioritized differential diagnosis? So how can we assess trainees' clinical reasoning? Like, what are their schemas and what's their differential diagnosis? Can we assess them? One final thing I'll say, if you look at the chat, if you have any questions for me, please feel free to put it in the chat. Nick is going to be my chat box moderator, and I will pause at various times for questions. Okay. Now, a diagnostic, so I'm using the terms clinical reasoning and diagnostic reasoning interchangeably. Diagnostic reasoning is a little bit simpler because we're just talking about the diagnosis, but you could apply the same method, or the same method has been applied for clinical reasoning, which includes like management problems and so on and so forth. I would say, and I've given all the kind of the psychiatry specific slides with a pink background. So just so you know that when you see a pink background, these are kind of just my thoughts about how this applies to the field of psychiatry. So in medicine, there's a high premium placed on the diagnosis. But in our field, we tend to think more about the formulation, which I agree is super important. I'm not going to go into great detail about formulation, how to make a formulation, but the ground elements you'll see in this talk. Now, formulation is, I think of it as superordinate to diagnosis. So you might say someone has bipolar disorder, but part of the formulation, for example, might be, do they think they have bipolar disorder? That's not a diagnosis, poor insight, but that's part of the formulation. Do they have a family who wants to help out the person with their diagnosis, or do they have a family that's antithetical to that formulation? So that's part of our antithetical to that diagnosis. So that's part of our formulation. So just want to contrast formulation, super important in psychiatry, diagnosis less so, but still important. And I for any of those of you who are interested, can we apply the similar methodology to the formulation psychiatry? That's an area that I haven't done that much work in. Would love some thinking in how we might be able to apply what I'm about to talk about into the area of formulation for those of you who are into that kind of stuff. Okay, so how does one, so, you know, I don't know how long ago this is, 20 years ago, people started to be really interested in what is clinical reasoning and how do you analyze it and how can you improve it? And one of the goals we're trying to do is moving past this idea of like, if someone makes a bad diagnosis, they just don't have enough knowledge. And then the treatment for that deficit in knowledge is to read more and see more patients. It turns out there's more to clinical reasoning than just a lack of fundamental knowledge and reading more and seeing more. What's been well known over time, and I'm not going to go through great details, but it's super fascinating, is like students, they need a lot more data to come up with less accurate diagnoses. As clinicians become more experienced, the amount of data they need to gather and their diagnostic accuracy is inversely proportional. Like you get better as you get more experience. How do we do this? Doctors, you know, experienced attendings, doctors, experienced clinicians have also, they get the chief complaint, history, exam, they get all this information. It goes into this black box, and then we come out with this, quote, diagnosis or formulation, if you will. So the idea is, how do we unpack this black box in here? Okay, so in the past, we have this gentleman here. Descartes sees the person. He says, lithium. I think this person needs lithium. Is this magic? Not really. Let's try to shine a block. So the idea is we're shining a light on this little black box called Descartes or the attending or whoever it is. How do they go from this to this? Okay. So here's the conceptualization of clinical reasoning in an outline form. We have three major parts. We have data gathering, problem representation, and illness scripts. And I'm going to go through each one of these one at a time. Okay. Data gathering is basically the studies and all the, you know, clinical interviews, ordering studies, labs, and so forth. That is part of gathering clinical data. Now, in the field of mental health, is the clinical interview is paramount. All those other things are a little bit like kind of rule out things. What really matters is the clinical interview. And I'm not going to go into great detail on that in this talk because that's covered in great detail elsewhere in the field of mental health. I'm going to talk a lot about problem representation, which is that classic one-liner. You know, this is a, you know, Mr. Smith is a 52-year-old man with depressed mood for the past 3 months. That's the classic problem representation. That is the beginning, it turns out, of our cognitive thinking and clinical reasoning of with patients. And then finally, when you have a problem representation, that activates illness scripts. This is kind of your fund of knowledge of all these illnesses that you have in your mind. And each one has their own kind of particular illness scripts. And there are three parts to illness scripts that I'm going to discuss, and that's building up illness scripts, like how do you just, you know, learn more, activating schemas. So schemas are more like these, like flow charts, or like if, when a student asks you, what's your approach to, they're asking you for your schema. What's your approach to depressed mood? What's your approach to suicide risk assessment? They're asking you for your schema, which is that little outline that outlines how you think about a problem. And then finally, how do we get at proposing a differential diagnosis? Because of all the things that go on, there may be multiple different diagnoses. How do we teach the students how to weigh which ones are more important, which ones are less important, which ones do we put on our differential diagnosis, which ones should drop out? So now it turns out these things, although I'm going to talk about them sequentially in order, they are not, this is not what experienced clinicians do. They don't gather data, then they do a problem representation, then they go through their brain in terms of selecting illness scripts. These all are happening kind of at the same time. So it's this very fascinating process where experienced clinicians are doing these things all at the same time, as when you're novices, they have to do each one very slowly and painstakingly, and that's normal. And our job is to kind of do it slowly and painstakingly with the trainee so that they kind of master each step along the way. So these things are happening all at the same time. And these are, and they affect each other too. So like if the patient says, well, I have a cough, the kinds of information we're going to ask about and studies are going to be affected by what our problem representation is. So these things all affect each other. So, okay, if we think we know about certain diagnoses, that will also affect like what we're going to ask about and how we think about the problem representation. Now, there are a couple verbs that I want to discuss with you about the that describe these kind of arrows, okay? So when we go from data gathering to a problem representation, that's called processing the history. So the patient tells us all these things and we come up with this one-liner. That's called processing the history. We're condensing it to a succinct statement of what the presenting problem is. That's the problem representation. Then when we hear a problem representation, we have what we call schemas, and we say we activate schemas. That's the verb for that. That in turn generates illness scripts for us to think about and select. And so if we think the diagnosis is obsessive compulsive disorder, we start to ask about obsessions and compulsions and what we know about obsessive compulsive disorder. So these things all are interacting. The other thing was we identify candidate scripts. We're proposing differential diagnoses. So as we begin to think of more diagnoses becoming more likely than others less, that affects our data gathering. That also affects our problem representation. Okay, again, these all happen at the same time, but for the sake of teaching, we're going to unpack these things one at a time. Is everyone following me here? Feel free to, I'm going to show this slide from time to time. This is my outline slide. So if you have questions, I'll try to take a brief pause here. If people have questions, this is the time to ask them. So you can raise your hand, I believe, in the chat.
Yeah, we haven't had any questions come in yet.
Okay, no worries. Okay, I'm not going to go into this in great detail. Data gathering is the history, the physical exam, diagnostic tests, et cetera. It's guided by our prior data, but it's also guided by schemas and our current problem representations. And that is, it's an iterative process. So we're going through this at the same time. Now, I just had a couple comments about data gathering in psychiatry that may be different from data gathering in other fields of medicine. These are just some of my thoughts. You know, rules of thumb, you know, for us, the longitudinal history is the key more than the mental status exam. That's stuff we teach the medical students right away. Just because the person right now says they feel paranoid, that doesn't mean they have schizophrenia, right? We have to get the longitudinal history. Do they have other associated signs and symptoms and so forth? So that's diagnostic. Recent is more important than remote. So example of that, if someone had a suicide attempt 20 years ago, that's way different than a person who had, that makes a big difference compared to someone who had a suicide attempt 20 days ago. So recent is more important than remote in terms of the history. So similarly for substances, if they had a remote substance abuse history versus recent, that makes a big difference. Collateral is more reliable. Now in other fields of medicine, they don't necessarily hold this to be true. In psychiatry, it's a kind of a general rule of thumb. If the patient says, you know, I'm fine, everything's great, and the partner of the person says, no, the person's been talking to themselves and it, like they're responding to someone who's like some internal voice in the head, we tend to think of the collateral as being more reliable. Of course, this statement is tempered by our experience and knowing, you know, the motivations of various parties involved in the patient's care. But in general, we think of collateral as being more reliable than the subjective history. Signs are better than symptoms. So objective findings are better than subjective judgments. So if the person says, well, I'm depressed because I don't have enough money, versus they say, I don't get out of bed at times, and I have trouble with my concentration and focus. I have no energy. I have crying spells all the time. These objective findings, or people who observe these things, can say that seems more reliable to us. And then crisis-generated data are suspect. So if the person comes to you in a crisis, or are hearing voices, or paranoid, we might suspect what they're saying. And then if in the DSM, at least, the diagnosis, the syndrome has to impair the functioning to reach the level of severity that qualifies for a diagnosis. So we're often interested in the interaction between the patient's symptoms and their functioning, which you may not be in, say, general medicine. If someone has acute chest pain, they still may be able to do everything they normally could do, but you know, they could be having a heart attack. So there's a difference in that regard too. Now, eventually, if someone has a heart attack, that will impair their functioning too, but in the acute setting, even. Okay, so that's all I want to say about data gathering. Very fascinating issue in psychiatry, but not that different in general than other fields of medicine. Okay, problem representation. What is this? Okay, the brain has to define a problem before it can solve it. That's the purpose of problem representation. So when the patient, so this is an example. Patient comes to us and says, and this is a general medical example, just to get us started. I have pain under my right rib after I eat on and off for the last 2 days, and it really hurts. That's what they say. Now, I don't go to a colleague and say, well, this patient has pain. I don't say that, because that doesn't generate, that's not a problem representation. I have to process the history. And what happens is I'll take these terms and I convert them into medicalese, for want of a better way of saying it. And what that means is I have a patient who has subacute, intermittent, severe, postprandial, right upper quadrant pain. That's how it gets translated to another doctor. And when another doctor hears that, they have a differential that automatically gets generated in their minds, okay? And these things come under my right rib. That gets translated into right upper quadrant pain. After I eat, gets generated to postprandial. Really hurts, severe, and so on and so forth. See what I'm saying? And then the next step is, once we get that kind of problem representation, that begins to generate a differential diagnosis in our minds. Like, is it rib pain or what is it? And these are some of the conditions that may present in that way. GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, peptic ulcer, costochondritis, for example, biliary colic or gallbladder problems. And then these three things, of all the illness scripts that we have, seem to match up a little bit better. So the brain begins to organize itself. This is what I'm thinking. These are the three main things I'm thinking about. And then based on that, you'll go and ask more questions or do studies to try to, what we call, rule those things out or investigate these most likely diagnoses. Now, what is the purpose of a problem representation? Problem representation, you can analyze it and grade it on whether it's good or not based on, does it answer these three questions? Does it answer who the patient is? For example, demographics, pertinent risk factors, okay? Not every risk factor, but pertinent risk factors. What is the syndrome? What are the key features of it? And what is the time course, okay? So you have a 32-year-old healthy man. The syndrome is severe postprandial right upper quadrant pain. And the time course is subacute and intermittent. Okay, my comments of this in psychiatry is that the time course generally is acute, is chronic or subchronic or intermittent. We don't have that many acute problem representations in our minds, because if someone has just a flash of being paranoid for a second, that doesn't mean anything to me, right? It has to be kind of persistent and either chronic or subchronic at least, or subacute at least, for it to reach significance. Okay. Now, the other way to think about this problem representation is that you are converting it into Googleable search terms. So this is the way I teach the medical students, because they understand what I mean by that. If you put in Google temperature of 103.2 Fahrenheit, you don't get anything. There are no diseases that correspond exactly with 103.2 degrees Fahrenheit, which is what the thermometer might show on the patient. But if you Google fever, then you will get a long list of diagnoses that correspond with the term fever. Okay, so that's why we convert it into these terms, because these are the terms that are Googleable, for want of a better word, or are triggered in our brain as being relatively generic, but specific, somewhat specific and somewhat generic, so that they narrow down the choices, but not too much. Okay, because 103.2 degrees Fahrenheit doesn't help Google understand what the diagnosis is. Fever does. Okay, so we have to translate what the patient says into these Googleable terms. Okay, so let's do a little practice here. Okay, so let me do a practice of problem representation here. So I'm gonna show you a little clip here of a video. This video, for those of you who have been around for a long time, may know it as The Fly, starring Jeff Goldblum and Gina Davis. In this clip, he is in the movie, he's a scientist, so like an engineering type tech person who is developing some work, okay? But let's just say you see this person in a bar, and here you have this man who, this is the mental status exam, and let's think about what kind of problem representation you can generate just with this. And I'm gonna stop the share and then start it again when I turn on the video. So let me just do that. And here he's in a bar or a little cafe talking with Gina Davis about his experiences. And if you ever get a chance to see the movie, I would recommend it. The Fly from 1980, I think. Okay, so what's your problem representation? So if you want to think about it, write down a few things, what would your problem representation be like?
So I asked the computer if it had improved me, and it said it didn't know what I was talking about. And that's made me think very carefully about what I've been feeling and why. And I'm beginning to think that the sheer process of being taken apart atom by atom and put back together again, why, it's like coffee being put through a filter. It's somehow a purifying process. It's purified me. It's cleansed me. And I'll tell you, I think it's going to allow me to realize the personal potential I've been neglecting all these years, that I've been obsessively pursuing goal after goal.
Do you normally take coffee with your sugar?
What? You know, I just don't think I've ever given me a chance to be me. But, of course, interestingly, at the exact same moment that I achieved what will probably prove to be my life's work, that's the moment when I started being the real me, finally. So, listen, not to wax messianic, but it may be true that the synchronicity of those two events might blur the resultant individual effect of either individually. But it is nevertheless also certainly true, I will say now, however subjectively, that human teleportation, molecular decimation, breakdown, and reformation is inherently purging. It makes a man a king. From the moment I walked out of the pod, I felt like $1 million. You know, I think I am going to have a cannoli after all. Waiter, I mean, what an accomplishment. But what have I really done, though? All I've done is say to the world, let's go, move, catch me if you can. Waiter, Jesus Christ.
All right. Let me stop share. So I want you to think about that clip. What's the differential diagnosis going through your mind? And let me just get back to this. By the way, this is from The Fly. If you're interested in the movie, it really gives a great, I'm not going to give it away just yet, but it's a really good movie. Jeff Goldblum does a wonderful job. It's definitely a B movie though, but it's kind of fun. Okay. So here's a novice student. After seeing this clip, this is what a novice student would say. 32-year-old, single, cisgendered, stably housed, white man in the tech field with a new girlfriend, possibly complex PTSD versus bipolar versus narcissistic personality disorder, who has a possible delusion of inventing teleportation. The student also may have put in sugar cravings in terms of his problems. Well, which elements seem unnecessary and distracting? And what would you develop as your own problem representation for this case? So if people could just put in the chat what they think would be our distracting features, maybe, or unnecessary. Now, David Elkin in the chat has gotten the answer correct, but he's seen the movie already, so it's not really fair. Nor is that pertinent to this talk. Any other thoughts about things you would not put in? Okay, I'm going to move along here. But yeah, so this is the stuff that the student tells you. How would you give the person feedback about their problem representation? So he tells you this, or she tells you this. What's your feedback to the student about this problem representation? A couple of you put in PTSD is not relevant, cisgendered. And so one of the things that the student has done is put in, and you know, for example, sugar cravings. We don't know any psychiatric disorders that cause sugar cravings, so we don't leave it in there, right? Okay. So now an experienced resident, here's what an experienced resident says. 32-year-old man with elevated expansive mood, grandiosity, and pressured speech with intermittent irritability. Think about that more experienced resident and how that person now does a problem representation. It automatically begins to generate, hopefully, in your mind, what the differential diagnoses are, correct? So that's the problem representation of an experienced person who's thinking about what are the things now that we need to rule out or investigate based on what we've just seen. And they've condensed it into a problem representation. Right? So the problem, the teaching points are, how do you, helping the person practice this kinds of things. So you can imagine now, if a student has trouble with this, reading more, getting more experience doesn't really help, right? What they really need to do is practice a problem representation. They need to understand the specificity of signs and symptoms. And when I mean specificity, I mean from an epidemiological point of view. Is it more specific to the disorder? So for example, things like pressured speech is relatively specific. There aren't that many psychiatric conditions that give you pressured speech. On the other hand, if the person said sugar cravings, it's not very specific for any psychiatric or medical disorder, as far as I know, right? So it's not as specific. Another example is the term fatigue. Fatigue is certainly a complaint that many patients have, but it's sensitive for diseases because you don't feel, if you're pretty ill, you have fatigue, but it's not specific. Because many illnesses cause fatigue. So it's not a particularly specific term. Then you want to emphasize medical terminology. Now in psychiatry, we have this intermediate thing because, for example, the term grandiose isn't really a medical term, for example, but it is kind of more specific. So it's more specific and has a special meaning for us in psychiatry in that we don't think of that many disorders associated with grandiose thinking or grandiosity. And then finally, the other things you're looking for is temporal, acute versus chronic. And in the clip, we don't have it since we just have a brief clip. It's just a mental status exam. We have qualitative, like are there other features that describe it, rest versus exertional, or contextual, so young versus old features. Okay, how long, how long it is, how old is the patient? Provide examples of problem representation. So the other key things about teaching problem representations is giving them good examples of good problem representations, eliminating the non-specific details. A couple of people in the chat had mentioned the gender or housing are really not pertinent. Ethnicity in this case is really not pertinent to the case itself, to the problem representation. Now, the formulation, it may be very critical. We would mention it for the formulation, but not for the diagnosis. Okay, and then you want to explain why you are emphasizing certain features, like what features are critical. So, for example, in medicine, we have a lot of things like, dyspnea on exertion. If the person feels short of breath when they exert themselves, that's different than when they feel dyspnea on rest. It gives you two different differential diagnoses. And students really basically just need opportunities to practice and repeat. For those of you who are really interested in AI and stuff, I think of the problem representation as helping the students learn, like develop like a neural network, that they're getting a lot of practice interpreting large sets of data and you're giving them practice at saying right or wrong about various combinations. And over time, they just kind of learn that's the correct thing. That's how a neural network learn. So if for those of you interested in that, my idea is that we're training the neural network of the brain to do this kind of problem representation. Now, just a quick aside is these problem representations do evolve over time as you get more data. I'm not going to go into details of that, but they will evolve. So for example, initially the person may be just happy. Later on, as you learn more about the patient, a more processed problem representation is elevated mood for 7 weeks. We may not be able to say that initially. Patient may eventually present with odd affect, which, by the way, I hear a lot of times from primary care providers, they say, oh, this patient's odd affect. With more data and more practice, the reporter can say, oh, this patient has poor eye contact with significant latency of response. That would be an example of odd affect that's more specific, right? Anxious can be converted, just as an example, over time with chronic anxiety with multiple somatic complaints. That's a way of a later problem representation that feeds forward after you've gathered more data. Okay, so that's the little piece about problem representation. That's a whole field that I've summarized for you in like 15 minutes here, but it's super interesting kind of thing to think about. Okay, let's talk a little bit about illness scripts. What are these? What are illness scripts? They're basically what they sound like. And two pieces of the illness scripts I'm going to talk about is activating schema and identifying candidate scripts, which is like proposing a differential diagnosis. Okay, so I separated this piece into three different parts: building up illness scripts, activating schemas, and script selection. Okay, build up illness scripts. How do we build up students' fund of knowledge? Well, we've learned some things over the past couple of decades. It turns out that in people's brains, this is the current conceptualization, we have these like files or folders in our brains that contain the following information: context, risk factors, clinical features, pathophysiology, treatment, illness course, memorable cases, anecdotes, recent reading studies, areas of ambiguity, clinical pearls. Now, everyone has their own illness scripts about pneumonia. Some are more developed than others. Mine is relatively primitive compared to my spouse's, who's an internist who deals with pneumonia somewhat, but not as much as, say, an pulmonologist who really knows a lot about pneumonia. They know all about the different areas of controversy or ambiguity in the research, and they have tons of clinical pearls and stuff like that. You could also think of it, conceptualize it kind of like a Wikipedia page, right? That also has the same kinds of content and stuff like that. So as an example. Now, for me, here's just a psychiatric example, bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder, I run our bipolar clinic, for those of you who don't know. And so I like to think my illness script for bipolar disorder is relatively sophisticated and elaborated. I know about predisposing factors, clinical consequences, time course and tempo. Now, one thing that makes psychiatry different about other fields of medicine is we only have theories about the pathophysiology of our disorders, and how that affects our illness scripts is, I think, very interesting. And also how it affects our schema and schema production is super interesting as well. I'll get to that in a minute. But the pathophysiology is something in my head that I know some theories about. What about diagnosing bipolar disorder? Like, do I need to get collateral information? Key thing for bipolar disorder is rule out substance abuse. You know, I have various things like that in my mind. Treatments for bipolar disorder, like mood stabilizers, atypical antipsychotics, avoiding antidepressants, those are things that are in my mind that may not be in the mind of, say, a primary care doctor, because their illness script about bipolar disorder is not as elaborated as mine. And so we have to think of these things as being under construction in our trainees, and they're constantly trying to build up their illness scripts and learning from us about illnesses. Okay, when we're teaching medical students, some of the key things to help them learn faster is to provide a big picture and scaffolding, if possible, about disorders, particularly connecting with pathophysiology. Now, we have trouble with this in psychiatry because we don't have a great pathophysiology, but providing the big picture of what it is, the key features of what the disorders, is the way to start. Not to teach all the little minutia first, but this kind of is common sense. Prioritizing key and differentiating fact features is very important too. And it turns out that comparing scripts is really helpful for students. So rather than just saying, okay, this person has a cough and they have pneumonia, learn all about pneumonia. This person has a cough. What's the difference between pneumonia and bronchitis? Because that's actually what happens in clinical care. So have the student learn things in combination or comparing two things. So when they're learning, they're not learning just about pneumonia. They're not just learning about bronchitis. They're learning to compare and contrast. What's the difference between the two? So similarly, if we're teaching about, say, psychosis, what's the difference between manic psychosis versus chronic psychosis with a thought disorder? Teaching the students to compare those two entities is the way to really help them remember it, because that's the presenting problem in our clinical environment, and also just helps to remember to compare and contrast as opposed to just memorize one list of features alone. And then finally, you want to emphasize common diseases, not the zebras. You want to, when you hear hooves, you want the students to hear horses, not zebras, okay? And so what the idea is encoding classic archetypes of disorders, and then atypical features are for the more advanced trainees. And then reading on their own patients they've actually seen, is probably more powerful than reading just in the textbook, divorced from the clinical environment. And then don't read about one condition alone, which I mentioned earlier. Read about two conditions at least in comparison. So those are the key understanding what illness scripts are and kind of how to teach it and how to interrogate illness scripts. Okay, schemas. What are schemas? So schemas are these things that the students are asking us about. What is your approach to? Okay, so if the student says, it's kind of like that outline form. If the person presents with psychosis, what are your different options for what it is? If the patient presents with cough, what's your schema for that? So for me, if someone presents with cough, my very primitive schema is like, should I go to a primary care doctor or should I get them to the emergency room? That's kind of my, the vast majority of a cough is just, you know, have them go back to their primary care provider. Okay. Now the advantage of schemas is it's not as fast as a problem representation, but it avoids missing categories of illness or premature anchoring of the student. So when you get the problem representation, automatically things come shooting in your mind about what it could be. Schemas help the person be more systematic so you don't forget things, okay? And it expands the differential diagnosis for a complex problem, and it helps trigger differentiating historical or physical exam maneuvers. So I'll give you an example here. So schemas, you have the problem representation in the picture frame that leads to different illness scripts. Schemas are like, how do you think about these in kind of this form? So I'll just give you an example of psychosis. You know, because we don't have a great pathophysiology of psychosis, I tend to think of it as psychiatric disorders versus general medical conditions, okay? And so under psychiatric, I tend to think of psychosis under three blocks: mood disorder, psychotic disorder, or thought disorder in the old parlance, or substance use disorder. Those are the three main buckets that I think of psychosis being associated with. And also some general medical problems I don't want to miss either. So when patients are delirious or demented or having temporal lobe epilepsy, those could be treat causes for psychosis also. But those are kind of the buckets that I'm thinking about. That way, and the reason why it's helpful to think about in schemas is you don't get locked in on bipolar manic psychosis. You remember to think about it could be some of these other things. Now, again, this is a pink slide here. So these are just some of my thoughts about what are the important schemas in psychiatry. These are the kind of the chief complaints that we have in psychiatry. And I think you'll notice that they're pretty limited. And the DSM, they're pretty limited. It's not like huge, like in medicine where they have like 100 chief complaints. We're modest, we're pretty finite. And I think you'll also notice that the DSM is actually organized in terms of schemas in some ways. So psychosis, psychotic disorders, mood disorders, anxiety disorders. We have excessive somatic concerns, cognitive syndromes, cognitive abuse, and chronic legal, social, / personality problems would be in another bucket as well. Now, excessive somatic concerns. Now, if someone presents with excessive somatic concerns, what's your schema? What's your approach to someone who just complains a lot about different psychiatric disorders? Is that a somatization disorder? What do you think of that? Well, it turns out that I actually think of it in kind of this is my schema. There's like somatization-related disorder. Nowadays, they're called somatic symptom disorder, illness, and anxiety disorders, factitious disorder, malingering. Some people with excessive somatic concerns, and this is an important rule out or just something to consider, is psychotic disorders. Like patients with schizophrenia and schizoaffective disorders often can also present with multiple somatic concerns as well, delusional often. And that's a different treatment than the other one. And then OCD, for example, can have multiple somatic concerns for cleanliness, hand washing, and so forth. Culture-bound syndromes are something that I think about excessive somatic concerns. And then there's some medical conditions also, less so. Okay. Oops. So that's just another example of a schema that I have in my mind about excessive somatic concerns that you want to make sure you think about. Now, the other thing that psychiatry is different than in medicine, they have what's called Occam's razor, meaning you want to try to get one diagnosis that explains all the symptoms. In psychiatry, if you have one diagnosis, that does not decrease the likelihood of the other diagnosis being true. In fact, it probably increases the likelihood. So the person could have a psychotic disorder like schizophrenia, and they could also have a somatic symptom disorder as well. So thinking about all of those things is important. And then culture-bound syndrome, someone wrote on the chart also, is another thing that I'd like to think about. Like, and it depends on what the excessive somatic concerns are, for example. So if someone is allergic to everything or fibers in the thing, there's a syndrome called Morgellons syndrome. That gets into a whole other theory of cultural anthropology and psychiatry. But the idea that there are certain culture-bound syndromes that may present with excessive somatic concerns, again, doesn't rule out the other ones, actually. It actually increases the likelihood. Okay, so the common diagnostic dilemmas I've listed here, and are they, I would also posit maybe they're schemas. So psychosis, insomnia, forgetfulness, attention problems, eating disorders. These are a couple of common ones. It's not meant to be exhaustive, but alcohol use disorder with someone's psychotic symptoms, panic disorder with a mood disorder, multiple somatic symptoms with a primary mood disorder, mood disorders, borderline personality disorder, complex personality disorders, you know. Okay, so anyways, just to summarize, the schemas provides a schematic, systematic approach for expanding the differential diagnosis and helps the student manage a cognitive load and maximize their problem-solving abilities, because the differential could be huge. And so when we give them a schema, we're kind of narrowing it down to them. And these schemas, by the way, are unique to individual clinicians and are enhanced by deliberate practice. So how do we coach them to develop schemas? Well, one way to do is ask the student, tell me, what's your approach to psychosis? What are you thinking about? That's a way to begin to assess the student's schemas. Again, this is not just a fund of knowledge issue. It's like, how do you think about how they're thinking? You ask them, tell me what you think about. How do you, when someone says that they've lost 20 pounds and don't eat enough, how do you think about that? What is it that, you know, food could be, you know, you want to hear that, you know, anorexia nervosa. You might want to hear, you know, maybe the person is paranoid about food and thinks it's poison. You want to hear them ask about that. Like, why does the person not eat, kind of thing. And you can help adjust and make additions to their schema with your own expertise. So for example, I just gave you one where the student is honed in on anorexia nervosa, but I'll say, hey, don't forget to ask about some of these other things. And just FYI, building up really good schemas that are really resilient, it takes a while and not too big and not too small. Okay. And these, again, schemas are really important for learners with limited illness scripts, meaning those who are just starting out and novices. They're not going to be able to solve cases by pattern recognition. Like some of us, we can watch that clip of the fly and say, okay, on my differential is bipolar mania. Students don't have that quickness of response. That's why we're experts and they're novices, that they need to have a schema by which to go on. Talk person with pressured speech. What's your schema for that? You know, they'll have to be more deliberate and analytic. Okay, so that's schemas. Now let me talk about a proposing differential diagnosis. Now, again, the UCSF medical students have been trained in all these things I'm telling you about. So they also have explicit rules for their differential diagnosis that we teach them. Okay, so we're gonna talk about that right now. So basically, and this is pretty simplified, but you basically wanna make sure that when they give a differential diagnosis, they wanna say what they think is the most likely, what they think it could be. It's not that likely, but you don't wanna miss this, okay? And three, something that's not just likely, it's kind of just a zebra. So you wanna have them make sure that they have some prioritized differential diagnosis and ask them why they said each one. Well, like, well, this person could have bipolar mania, but I really wanna make sure that they're not having methamphetamine abuse. That's like an important rule out that we wanna make sure that the students, that's an important part of your differential diagnosis that we should always check. Okay, so, so this is a differential diagnosis by a learner. The differential is broad and includes pheochromocytoma, sepsis, hyperthyroidism from Graves' disease, alcohol withdrawal, anxiety or panic disorder, pulmonary embolism, myocardial infarction, or atrial fibrillation. Next example of a differential diagnosis that is not organized, that's not differential, it's not prioritized, okay? So what we wanna do is teach and practice explicit rules and learn how to make them more condensed and prioritized. Okay, so now what are the principles of diagnosis in psychiatry? And maybe these are specific to mental health. And so these are the pink slides, are just kind of my thoughts about things. One is we do have the principle of parsimony, although it's not as strong as in medicine, which again, Occam's razor, meaning trying to narrow it down to just as few diagnoses as possible. There's also the contravailing Hickam's dictum. Hickam's dictum is, patient can have as many diseases as he damn well pleases, meaning, you know, Hickam's dictum is the opposite of Occam's razor. The principle of chronology. So like if the person has elevated mood first and then has hearing voices, we think of the mood disorder taking precedence over the psychosis. Whereas if they have hearing voices telling them to use methamphetamine and then they start using methamphetamine, we think of the hearing the voices. The chronology is very important to us. Principle of safe diagnosis. If you miss the diagnosis, you don't want to. So it's very similar to like a can't miss diagnosis. And what are the consequences? So we like to make diagnoses of things that are more favorable. So if the condition is due to a general medical condition, that's more favorable to us. If it's due to major depressive disorder or bipolar disorder, that's a more favorable diagnosis because in general we have better, not perfect, but better treatments for those disorders. Middle diagnoses with less favorable but not terrible prognoses are alcohol dependence, panic disorder, phobia, OCD, anorexia nervosa, substance use syndrome, borderline personality disorder. Least favorable, so diagnosis we don't make as much because it's not as treatable, although I think that is we're beginning to change our views about these things because we're getting to have some treatments and interventions, particularly early on in like schizophrenia, that are more favorable. But so least favorable diagnoses are like schizophrenia, antisocial personality disorder, and dementia. And then the principle of percentages, just common things are common. So when someone makes a diagnosis of Capgras syndrome, that is kind of cool, but it's not that common. So depression is common, for example. So that's how you make your diagnosis, also based on how common is it. Okay, so these are my list of psychiatric diagnoses are frequently missed: substance use syndromes, schizophreniform psychosis, borderline intellectual functioning, often getting diagnoses, personality disorders. I think bipolar disorder, but you know, I'm the chief of the bipolar disorder clinic, so of course I think it's missed frequently. When you hear hoofbeats, these are common disorders, as I mentioned earlier. And these are some rare disorders. And when I say rare, I just mean rare in the psychiatric setting. That doesn't mean they're rare in general in the population, but just rare in a typical outpatient psychiatric clinic. These are learning disorders, although, as I just mentioned earlier, we miss them a lot. Gender identity disorder, it's becoming more common now. Tourette's, autism, delusional disorder. We see less of them just because people present less frequently to us with these diagnoses, at least in an adult psychiatric outpatient clinic. Okay, so I'm getting close to the end of my presentation here. So just remember, I'm talking about diagnosis, but I do think that formulation, which is another key skill of a mental health professional, I have not addressed at all. So if anyone's ever interested in this, applying this method or thinking about how we can think about formulation, love to talk to you more about that. I know a lot has been written about it, but to translate what's known about clinical reasoning into our formulation, I think would be kind of cool. And then just a reminder, we have, I talked about data gathering, problem representation, and illness scripts as the three main things that we do in clinical reasoning. The data gathering has been discussed elsewhere. So the two main things that you may have a sense of already, and I'm just repeating them, is problem representation and illness scripts. And again, remember, reminding you of the verbs, when we take the history and we process it into a problem representation. And when we do a problem representation, the intention of the problem representation is to activate certain schemas and then help the person identify candidate scripts. So just to summarize, data gathering, problem representation, illness scripts, they're all happening at the same time in experienced clinicians. So, but we're just teaching them one at a time. And again, just to mention that this effort to teach clinical reasoning has been going on for 20 years. It's much more well-developed in internal medicine and other areas of medicine than in psychiatry and the mental health field. So if you go online, you can learn about clinical reasoning, this methodology, it's a very specific term that uses this. And so there's the Society to Improve Diagnosis in Medicine. And basically this is the methodology that's being taught throughout most medical schools and online. So this teaches you not only about clinical reasoning, but also how to teach clinical reasoning. For those of you like podcasts, this is an internal, so you have to be kind of a nerd like myself who enjoys like listening to fields outside of psychiatry, but listening how internists think about clinical reasoning. These two just use this terminology and are just talking about different diagnoses, often go through different patient presentations using this and talking it through. It's really fun for those of you who are so inclined. And then here are other resources that are included in the slide set. And if Nick, would you mind putting it in again in case people who came on a little late didn't get it, they can see the link. And then again, some of the pink slides I got, actually, I got those ideas from Boarding Time, which is now out of print, but this is an excellent way of actually help giving you some ideas how to think about clinical reasoning in a shortcut kind of way. So that's it. If you want to learn more, please email me. And I got about 5 minutes, is that correct, for discussion or questions?
That's right. And since it's a pretty small group and we're all friends here, if you have a question or a comment, why don't you just go ahead and unmute yourself and ask or comment away.
Descartes, this is Dominic. Just a question about what for, you know, more seasoned clinicians of any kind, what are perhaps some typical kind kind of errors that can get fossilized in the clinician with clinical reasoning?
I think the most common things that happen to residents and students is premature anchoring. So I think that's probably a little different than in medicine, whereas so I think there are two things. One is we either have premature anchoring or the trainee is in a abyss or a vat of symptoms and has trouble like seeing the forest for the trees, as it were. So, you know, when Ray and I are precepting in clinic, we get these complicated patients, but we can, you know, we kind of consolidate the patients into a couple of key clinical questions that we've seen many times before. And that kind of thing is harder for students to see, that kind of thing. So an example would be like patient comes to us with a lot of symptoms of borderline personality disorder, but also a lot of soft symptoms of, say, bipolar disorder. And I think we see that pretty frequently. That's a common presentation. And Ray and I have kind of just, one, what are the key differentiating features? Two, learning to live with that differential as an entity in and of itself. Like, we don't have to come down on one side or the other. And then the other contradistinction is the resident who comes down prematurely onto one or the other, or it's bipolar disorder, or it's borderline personality disorder, and premature anchoring onto one to the exclusion of the other one. Those are the kind of the two common things that I see. Sam's got his hand up.
Yeah, I would just like to congratulate you, Descartes. It's very heartening to see that this is what our students are being taught now. I remember the days when there were disagreements about whether there was even such a thing as a diagnosis in psychiatry, and having this protocol and recognizing its ambiguities and building an ability to size people up thoughtfully and systematically, and recognizing the AI analogy that a lot of it is happening in neural networks, but you need a schema for putting, it's great. I just wanted to chime in and congratulate you and tell you how pleased I am to see where things are now.
Thanks, Sam. I think it's a fascinating fact. You know, as psychiatrists, love to think about thinking. It's a little bit of a bummer we're so behind our internal medicine colleagues, but I hope we can catch up with them soon. Any other questions?
We do have one question that came in with the on the chat from Barbara. Excuse me. Does the discipline of coding help or interfere with this sort of sequential reasoning when it's applied to very complex situations?
Well, my personal thought is this is where the formulation comes in. I think we do want to come up with our diagnoses. That's important, but we can't forget about the formulation. And what I mean by formulation, there is a psychoanalytic psychological formulation, which is, of course, critical, but also a formulation that doesn't necessarily include those things too. Formulation things like I mentioned earlier, like a supportive family, that's a critical piece of your formulation. So the students understand that as part of their assessment. So there's a difference between an assessment and a diagnosis. So like you have the diagnosis, which is this one term disease entity, but that doesn't mean the family isn't important or isn't critical to either generate or ameliorate the diagnoses, as it were. So whether it's diabetes or schizophrenia or bipolar disorder, I think, so where we can help out is in our formulation, we do have the psychological aspect, which is a little bit different than our internal medicine colleagues, that not only do we have a biological and social formulation, we also have the psychological ones as well. But I have to say, you know, most doctors in general may have some psychological formulation of the problem as well. I'm not sure if I'm answering the question, Barbara. Please feel free to chime in if you'd like to clarify further. And
Descartes, this is so fascinating. It's just a wonderful way to sort through and think about what are we actually doing when we talk with students and how do we structure this? What I'm wondering is, you know, I think about my kids who of course grew up with computer programming, and I wonder what their inherent logical formulations are that might differ from mine. And does it help or interfere with this kind of sequential reasoning with a lot of human and complex factors thrown in?
Yeah, I had a lot of trouble with my computer when my IT department went away to college. So I know what you mean. They think differently. My kid made his own computer, made their own computer. Like I never heard of such a thing. So, I think what The analogy is helpful for them, but it's still an analogy. We don't know exactly how the brain works. It's probably another, I think it's a useful way to think of computers and neural networks and like network. I was very interested in the computer Alpha Zero, the computer program that learned how to play chess by itself, just by playing itself, and actually just built up its own neural networks, its own network thinking in terms of how to play the game of chess and could defeat anyone else on the planet after practicing for 4 hours. So I think they have a leg up in understanding when I say neural network, they get what I would mean by training a neural network. But, you know, my kids are not tech people. So I think they're going to be, you know, there will be other generations ahead of them. And there already are generations ahead of them. And the rest of us are just falling behind. Sad to say.
Thank you.
Ray's got a comment. Yeah, if you read the chat, I think Ray's got a perfect comment. I don't want to read it again if anyone has any.
All right. Well, we are right up against 2 o'clock. So we're going to have to go ahead and call this. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Thank you, Descartes, for a fantastic presentation. The next Intensive Services Grand Rounds will be on February 28th. With Chris Bartley talking about autoimmune disorders and psychosis. So that'll be great. Hope you can join us for that. Thank you again, and we'll see you later.